In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever, and to ages of ages. Amen. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory forever.
I don't want to get into the debate over demons and spirits and all of that stuff. More than likely, as we know now, this young boy was afflicted with a natural disease, probably epilepsy, something like that, which was ascribed in the ancient times to things like demons. I'm not saying there aren't any, but most of the time, it was something more natural than that. But that's not the point of today's sermon. What Jesus says about such conditions as this, this overwhelming condition that the world is in, the fallen world of disease, and yes, even of evil spirits and of sin and all of those things, this kind can only come out with prayer, he says to his apostles. And St. Matthew's Gospel adds, and fasting. These words were not spoken to the boy and his father, they were spoken to the apostles, who wondered why they were unable to heal him. I think it was because they were still novices and babes in the spiritual life. The revelation was given to them gradually as they were able to bear it. Even in the transfiguration, the apostles do not see the fullness of his divinity. Who could ever see that? It is infinite. This year, I have thought about the question of Lent in regards to this kind of prayer and fasting we have to do. And when Lent approaches, I know most of us get all excited or anxious, either way, about it. Can I do it? What should I do? Is it worthwhile? Was last year any good for me? And some of us, actually, the more pious of us, I say in quotations, get out our spiritual Superman suit from our mothballs and slip it on like every year for 52 days so that we can at last get really serious about the spiritual life. And then after Pascha comes, the crash. Everything we work so hard to do falls apart and life returns to normal. We go, what was it worth? Was it worth all that effort? Well, seems there is no time off for good behavior. Nothing really changes at all if that's our approach. Oh well, we think maybe next year will be better. But I think we need to go about it a little differently. If Great Lent is the preparation for Holy Pascha, then the entire rest of the year should be a preparation for Lent. Lent is supposed to be a tuning up of a working vehicle, not the jump start of a dead battery. If we had been practicing the spiritual life all through the year, then we would not fall into the traumatic malaise after Pascha. And this leads us back to the gospel. All of us have certain passions in our lives that need a whole lot of prayer and fasting. They cause us great suffering. We return to those same old passions and sins over and over again as if we were possessed by them. And in a sense, we are. Our repeated falling into the same old stuff becomes a pattern. We become programmed and conditioned to keep repeating them. Our brains become wired to this repetition. The pattern must be broken. It is interesting that science and psychology have shown that it takes 6 weeks to break an addiction, but it takes complete abstinence from whatever you're addicted to. 6 weeks. How long is Great Lent, you suppose? It's kind of 6 weeks. Each time we resist the pattern of conditioning and programming, it weakens as the brain begins to rewire itself to other possibilities and different ways of responding to the same old stimuli. A spiritual life of meditation, prayer, and fasting, and I mean fasting not just from food on Wednesdays and Fridays, but from the thoughts that lead us to react in these sinful, harmful, and unhealthy ways, is how the pattern is broken. That's the point of the ascetic life, to change the way we think so that the way we live can change. The new patterns of behavior must be practiced and repeated consistently and regularly, or the old patterns will simply reassert themselves. 52 days of some spiritual work may help, but it is not enough. Jesus asked the paralytic, "Do you want to be healed?" Jesus will not force his healing on us, nor will he surprise us with it. Our cooperation is required. If we really want it, we have to, as the Philokalia says, call upon his aid and also awaken in us the natural powers that God has placed in us from our creation. After all, Jesus famously said, "Physician, heal yourself." So, some suggestions on how to begin to awaken these natural powers and put them to use. First, stop blaming others for our suffering. The unhappiness resides in us like a time bomb, as the potential for happiness does. No one and nothing in this life has ever made us happy or unhappy. It is our internal response to what happens outside of us that makes us happy or unhappy. So you can't blame anybody else, not even the devil, for your sins, folks. If you didn't cooperate, it wouldn't happen. The problem lies in our thoughts and not in the behavior of other people. If we are used to making ourselves unhappy, then even if our spouses send flowers to our door every day, we will still find something to complain about. Secondly, we need to go inward to those secret, dark places we fear to go, but not alone. We must go with God, whose light cannot be extinguished by that darkness. And with the aid of a confessor or spiritual father or mother, guiding us, taking us by the hand, and going with us. Very important. We go with God preeminent in our thoughts as we look deeper and deeper for those things in us that need attention. This is the place of meditation and prayer. Learn to meditate, learn to pray, and then practice them each and every day, religiously. This is where the sacrament of confession is most helpful. Confession is not a mere reading of a sanitized list, laundry list of sins. It is a revealing of life as it is at this moment and an exploration of what needs to be done to make it better. This is also the place of psychological counseling. Very good thing as well. I recommend mindfulness-based therapies because they wed the best of psychology with the best of spiritual practice in a most effective way. Neuroscience has confirmed the therapeutic practice of the Holy Fathers of our church in remarkable ways, and modern psychology is finally catching up. Thirdly, we must change whatever is in our environment that contributes to our suffering. Subtly, our conditioned minds work to arrange the world around us in ways that support its dysfunction. We need to be aware of this and change everything that must be changed. This means that we need to alter the way we think, live, and behave. Again, the change that must happen is a change in ourselves. This kind cannot come out without prayer and fasting. If we want to experience the life-changing power of the gospel, then we must start to practice the gospel and let nothing get in our way. A spiritual teacher once said, there are two mistakes one can make in the spiritual life. One, not starting at all, and the other, not going all the way. Use the rest of the year after Pascha to prepare for Lent 2012. And then You may see something happen in your life. Practicing the teachings of Jesus day in, day out, throughout the year will show us just how good the good news is. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.